This is Life Rewired, the Brain Injury Podcast, for survivors by survivors. And now your host, Rob and Ashley.
But nothing like that to throw you out. Do you remember what I was saying? Nova. This just hurts my soul.
I did for like a split second. Oh, wait, we were talking about medications and...
Oh, the symptoms, how the symptoms are the same. The symptoms are the same as the side effects.
Yeah. Yeah.
Like, how are we going to process that? How are we going to navigate that? Like, you know, and these doctors, I mean, I've watched neurologists load people on so many medications.
Yes.
How are they possibly able to function? It's like, you know, in the world that I operate with some people, I call that a chemical straitjacket.
Yeah.
They just drug us.
I've never thought of it that way, but now that you've said that, yes, I totally agree with you. My first neurologist, the first thing he did, he didn't want me to get any treatment, first of all. He wanted me to wait 2 years to see if I got better. And my wife was like, no. Oh, yeah. This was at the very start of COVID when everybody had to mask up and everybody had to one-on-one. You couldn't have a bunch of people in the waiting rooms. So I had to do this all by myself. Hmm. And with someone who's fresh to the brain injury world, they need an advocate, but I didn't have that.
Yeah.
So I go into his office and he asked me my date of birth was the first thing he asked me. And I couldn't remember. He slammed his pen down on the table. He goes, the questions are just going to get harder from here.
That was your neurologist?
Yes.
Yeah, fire that guy immediately.
Yeah.
That's what I call a medical abuser.
Yeah. He put me on a medication for, I forget what it was called, but it was basically for people who have epileptic seizures.
Do you remember the name of the medication?
No, I don't. My wife would, and she's not here. I'll find out for you, though. I will find out.
I'm curious.
But it made me a zombie. And I'll be honest with you. I feel like it made me more want to end my life than it did help me.
It made me more depressed. It made me feel more hopeless. It made me feel more helpless. It made me feel like there aren't any answers for me. You know, and you know, half the doctors, they don't understand how important the anecdotal experience is.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they're not listening to us, which talk about rage. That just makes my blood boil.
Right.
You know, how does a medical system sit here and say, I'm here to help you, but they don't help you? One, you can't have access to care with brain injury. Insurance denies 3/4 of the things that you need.
Yes, absolutely. Right? The things that can actually help us.
Right.
They don't want to give us.
For instance, I had to get a medical sponsor in order to obtain hyperbaric oxygen therapy. It was over $12,000 for 40 sessions.
Are you kidding? Wow.
Yep.
And who can afford that?
Nobody.
You know,
I went to the Amen Clinic in California because I first of all, the only way I've ever really seen my brain injury before that was in my cognitive therapist results, where I was moderately to severely cognitively impaired in being able to process information, problem solve, memory recall, memory retention, and word finding. All my strong suits as a spoken word artist. But that was the only way I could really measure what was wrong with me outside of the emotional volatility, right? I didn't understand that I had lost a filter. I didn't understand that I had lost my impulse control, right? I didn't understand any of this. And unless we have the doctors there to help us point out the symptoms, to help us identify what we're going through, to get the appropriate therapies, had I not had cognitive therapy, I would have never known that. You know what I would have told people? Like most other brain injury survivors that have never gotten the care. I feel off.
Yeah.
I don't know what's going on. Like, I don't, I'm scared. I mean, half the time we don't even know how to say we're scared, you know? Yep. And, like,
you described that perfectly. You do feel lost. It's yeah. like, I know who I am. I know what I should be doing. I can't function, but I'm alive. I can see everything around me. I just cannot function.
See, what people don't understand is we're still here. We're still here. We're still talking to ourselves.
Yeah.
Right? That being in the body. I don't know if you've ever heard of KRS's one description of the fifth dimension, but as he says, he uses, I'm going to do my best. He takes a Rockstar energy drink and he says, now I want you, without using your mouth, just say the word Rockstar in your head. Say the word Rockstar. And so everybody does. And he goes, now you just spoke words without speaking. You heard words without ears. Who is that? It's the being inside of us, right?
Yeah.
Like, and so we're still here. And I kept telling everybody, because I was a near internal decapitation, and we can talk about this another time, is that my brainstem woke back up about 2 years ago, which was a very profound experience for me. But I used to tell people through my injury, I'm here, but I'm not here. Mm-hmm. I'm here, but I'm not here. I don't feel connected to myself. Mm-hmm. I'll tell you what, when this lit back up, I came back.
That's awesome.
I'm still different. I'm still very much different because the brain's not operating the same.
You know? Right. Even though that you are back, your ability, your gas can in your car used to be huge and you could fill that thing up and run all day long. Now you got a little bitty gas can. Mm-hmm. And it only holds so much. And once it's gone, it's gone.
Yep.
And that's our capacity. Hardest thing. Yes. That's the hardest thing for people to understand.
Yeah. You know, because we look normal. We sound normal. Right.
And I might look normal today, and tomorrow I could be totally off. One day this week, I didn't notice it because it's kind of like second nature to me now.
Right.
But my wife was saying, you're slurring your words. You need to go home and take a nap.
I'm so grateful that she's able to recognize those signs and be a real world reference point to you. Mm-hmm. Hey, I can tell you're not really here right now.
Oh yeah.
Right. Because we're not very present when that's happening. Mm-hmm. We're barely surviving. You know, the body literally goes into survival mode. And so what kicks in? That cortisol. And then that cortisol kicks in. It's that fight or flight, right? That's why. I mean, if you really think about that rage, right? When we get that depleted, mm-hmm. and we go into that fight or flight, that cortisol kicks in, and we get all amped up, and we're ready to go. You know, and
right, it's almost like you're on autopilot.
Right? Have you ever seen the movie "Brain Damage: The Truth About Trauma"?
No.
Highly recommend it.
Where can I see it at?
I think you can either rent it on Prime or I think you can rent it on Magellan. Just type in "Brain Damage: The Truth About Trauma." The movie will come up. Okay. It's only like $2.99, I think, to rent it. But it's kind of like a documentary. So it takes like brain injury survivors that have had it really bad, and like it talks about, you know, it takes a story about a person who went so red he killed his girlfriend.
Wow. Right?
Like and it gives in these incredible statistics, like brain injury survivors are 400 times more likely to suicide. Brain injury survivors are 200 times more likely to fall into substance abuse. That 90% of marriages fail because of brain injury, because we become so much of a different person, and everything becomes chaos. And that 60 to 80% of people who are homeless or incarcerated, some sort of unhealed TBI.
Wow.
And if you really think about it, TBI is, and I will go as far to say that it is an epidemic. It's everywhere. You know, yeah. I mean, let's look at what the NFL
have it. that don't know they have it.
100%. Because, you know, you were talking about how the world and how we would view brain injury before we had brain injury. Mm-hmm. You heard the word concussion. You dismissed it.
Yeah. I just thought, oh, you'll be fine tomorrow. That was exactly what I felt.
I will never tell anybody that I had concussions. I will tell them that I had traumatic brain injuries because, first of all, there is no mild traumatic brain injury. Mm-hmm. Then they really need to change those classifications.
Right.
Because, you know, I had a mild, no, I had, now that I recognize I lost consciousness, that puts me into, I think, what, a moderate. But,
yeah.
Because the LOC is the difference between there. And so, but, man, I'm really losing my thought process today.
You were talking about the classifications of the brain injuries or concussion.
Yeah. I will, because, you know, when I say traumatic brain injury, that sticks. That sounds like it is as painful and harmful and hurtful as it is.
Yeah.
You know? And so, you know, it's the education needs to happen. I think the more we have these conversations, the more we can help caregivers and we can help survivors understand their experiences. And we can be a bridge to mediate the conversation.
Absolutely.
I have learned by describing my experiences to some caregivers that they are actually able to see their survivor in ways they couldn't recognize.
Mm-hmm.
And they can now navigate that better. They can now support them better.
Yeah.
Right? But that rage, man, that rage will get us. And when you talk about that movie, like, you know, that rage, some people actually can go as far to harm people and hurt people.
Yeah.
And so it's important to recognize if it's that bad, like, really ask for help. Get TBI counselors, please. If any of you don't understand or know about a TBI counselor, look them up. They exist. They specialize mm-hmm. in it, and they work only with people who have traumatic brain injuries.
Yep.
That woman saved my life.
And you said recognizing, in ourselves, I guess, basically earlier you said something about, you know, things prior to and post the brain injury. I never had anger at all before my injury. My wife will tell you the entire time we have been married, she has only saw me mad one time prior to. Yeah.
Yeah.
So she says, let everything slide off your back like it was nothing. And she said, now it's like you got a chip on your shoulder.
Yep.
Everything, a lot of chips on my shoulder.
Everything we've ever held inside, anything that we've ever been like, no, I'm not going to deal with that. I'm just going to keep it inside. And that's why I had to do so much trauma work. And I do encourage anybody who has a brain injury to do trauma work, because we have been traumatized in so many ways. But here's the bigger kicker, is I had done a lot of work on my trauma before brain injury. I was really standing in my, you know, 8 C's of self-leadership. I was standing in my light. I'm the co-founder of the Phoenix Festival of the Arts. So I was like, I was really like doing a lot of great things in our community. And I lost it again.
You were the co-founder of the Phoenix.
Right before that.
My ability to completely recall really just sort of not the
way. You know, well, it is later in the day, especially for you, but I just got done telling that story, right? About how I was tired and all that. And I've been pretty busy. So I accept and embrace the fact that my thoughts aren't holding as well as they normally do. I hope that other people can see that we can have some compassion around that. And that we're not fighting that. I have a big saying: we cannot heal when we are in resistance.
This is true. So true.
We cannot heal when we're in resistance.
we're showing it works and all, guys. I mean, this is a small, small glimpse into what it's like to be living with a traumatic brain injury. You know,
we couldn't even do a 12-hour episode.
No, we could go for
weeks. We honestly couldn't. For real. I mean, what I think, and that's an important, topic, I think, as well, is to, it's not one thing. It's everything.
Yeah.
So when you think of the complexities of life, it's everything. And I was just telling my friend as I started to have a meltdown after the everything, like I just broke down and hugged my friend and cried. You know, I'm just like, I don't know what I'm going to do. You know, I'm trying to figure my life out. Right. Oh man, it is bad today.
Something you were telling your friend.
Oh man, it's all good. But just that we can work around this and have compassion for ourselves. I was talking about the layers. So I said, you know, there's so many layers of things that I have to go through right now. And I'm having trouble sifting and sorting through them. But once I'm trying to take one layer at a time because I can't. You know, my mantra is one step, one breath, one moment at a time. That's all I can handle. Mm-hmm. And because if I have any other expectations beyond that, it gets worse. So I said, but the problem is like once I get through one layer, all the other layers have gotten thicker.
Yes.
And it's so overwhelming. I'm having a hard time catching up, keeping up.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, you just feel like you're just watching everybody in the kayaks leave you behind in the ocean.
Yep.
And you're like, guys, I'm here. Don't you love me too?
And do you find sometimes that there are days that finding the ability to just give two F's is just not there?
No, it isn't.
No matter what.
And I will tell you right then and there, the moment that you can't function in the day, you need to rest.
Yeah.
Do not push yourself. We cannot push ourselves like that because, you know, if we can't connect to care, then that mm-hmm. says that we are not well.
Right.
And we either need to rest or we need to reach out to our medical team or our real world reference points. People that help us understand what reality is. You know, we need that person. It's important because, you know, what people don't understand is our brain is our computer processor.
Mm-hmm.
It's everything. It's taste. It's all of our senses. It's body thermal regulation. It's sight. It's thought processes. It's emotional regulation. It's digestion. It's sleep. You know, it's... Mm-hmm. Is all of it. It's every single aspect that anybody is existing in. And that's, I think, what makes it. Brain injury survivors are special. Why are we special? Because we appreciate the small things that have been taken for granted.
You said a mouthful.
Yeah, we lost
it. Said a mouthful.
Right? So we see the world in a different way.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, it takes time to be able, it takes patience to navigate and work through this, to be able to embrace yourself, accept yourself, you know, love yourself, to stop fighting it and to start taking steps in the forward. Because we cannot, you know, I was talking to a friend of mine, like, you know, anxiety and worry puts us in the future.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yeah.
And you know, depression and the other aspects and comparisons, right? They anchor us like a chain on our ankle to the past.
Yeah.
How can we be present? How can we move forward if we're literally physically chained to the past? You know, which is, I think what I was saying earlier that, I was encouraging people to do the trauma work because I had done the work on trauma. This just came back to me, so I'm coming full circle. Is the trauma work, I had done so much work in being able to identify my traumas, A, with my mom and you know, my medical traumas. I was in a wheelchair 4 times as a kid, all, you know, all the different things. Yeah. And I had done the work around it, but what happened after brain injury was I thought I had processed them, but I had really compartmentalized them. So I had put them in boxes and said, you know what? You're a little too much for me to deal with. So I'm going to put you right over there. I'm going to forget about you. Right. Yep. So when brain injury happened, it was an earthquake and all those boxes fell off the shelf and all of my traumas re-entered myself. They bonded with me like a seamless chemical bond. And I had no idea. The first time I recognized I was having that my traumas had shown up and come back was I was screaming at my son in a full on TBI rage. My son didn't want to do his homework or he got in trouble. He was out of a bad grade and he's being a normal at the time, 16-year-old kid. And I would approach that beforehand as, you know, age appropriate expectations. He's a 16-year-old boy. He doesn't want to do his homework. But what happened instead? I'm screaming and I'm yelling. Why? Because I started to recognize that my physical emotions, that I was anchored in the past. I was trauma triggered. I was responding to him emotionally and physiologically like he was my mother manipulating me because he was manipulating me. And yes. And so, that was like, okay, we need to do some work. You know?
It's totally amazing. It is. It's just, have you ever done EMDR by any chance?
I actually am doing EMDR coupled with that internal family systems IFS. So yes, I have.
Yeah. I'm telling you what,
work.
I'll tell you some things off the air that I'm not ready to share with the world yet.
Fair enough.
Yeah, it's deep. It opens EMDR will pull those little things that you've even got tucked under the corners that you don't know are there.
Yep. There. You know what happens. You know how that works, right? The trauma got stuck in one side of the brain, okay? And so when you start doing EMDR and you have the bilateral stimulation, whether it's visual or visual or audio or tactile, right? Whether they have the buzzers. I was talking to my counselor about this because when I do EMDR, because I'm naturally accepting, I don't resist. As soon as I identify something, I feel and I process. So I'll move through it pretty quickly and he'll watch my eyes start to do this with my eyes closed. So he doesn't have to bilaterally stimulate me because I start bilaterally stimulating myself. And so the reason they do the bilateral stimulation is for 2 reasons from my understanding, is that because the trauma got stuck in one side of the brain, it needs to process in the other and the roadway is blocked. So when they start doing the bilateral stimulation, they clear that roadway. So when you clear that roadway, you get that flood of all of the trauma and the emotions that you had been blocking, right? And then they also do the bilateral stimulation because as you enter the memory that you're reliving, because you have to relive a memory in EMDR, right? So as you're reliving your memory, it's the counselor's job to keep you from disassociating, to recognize you for, that are getting too and and it brings you back. One of the best tools I use is I recognize when I start disassociating in regular life, I'll literally like rub my fingers together so that I feel that and it brings me back to present, or I'll take my fingers and I'll just gently scratch them on my thigh, or I'll like, that is the McDonald's sign. And I'll say that out loud so that I can become present. I'll use my senses to bring me back.
Wow. I'm going to try that.
Let me know how it works.
Yeah, I will.
Yeah.
I will share this with you real quick. We tried the bouncing ball. Have you done the both? Have you done the taps or have you do the bell?
No, I haven't done either. With the EMDR?
Yeah.
So when I do EMDR, we just go into a memory and he doesn't have to do any of that with me because my eyes already start going.
Gotcha. Yeah. We tried the ball. That does not work because I concentrate on the ball and I'm going 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. I'm not thinking. I'm just constantly, I'm counting.
Yeah.
Right. So
we can't multitask that.
No.
Got it. Yep.
I cannot. My wife would say I can't single task.
I want to meet your wife one day.
She wants to meet you. We'll make this happen.
I love it.
But one of those things that we do, we'll do the tapping with the clicks so I can keep in balance with it.
Yep.
And my Alexa's talking. I have no idea why. Anyway, she...
Alexa, you're talking about... stop. Right?
I'm trying to single task.
If this isn't a perfect example of what happens to people with brain injury, who are brain injury survivors, then we can... talk about ADHD.
Right? I'll have to tell you an ADHD story off the air because it's hilarious. Yeah.
Okay, so you were talking about how you're tapping.
The tapping. So it did bring a lot out. But one thing that we couldn't understand was one week I said, I just keep getting images of little Richard. And she goes, she's confused just as much as I am.
Right.
And then another thing was I kept seeing a lady with no face, and that bothered the crap out of me. And, you know, she said, you know, pay attention to your dreams because it will often come out in your dreams.
Right.
Nothing. So for weeks, I could not figure out who this lady with no face is. So last week in our session, we're sitting there talking and all of a sudden I go, oh my gosh. She goes, what? I said, behind you in the window. She had a little statue that was a planter. Mm-hmm. It looked like a lady with no face. Wow. Why or how it got
into the subconscious is so crazy. Yeah.
Isn't that crazy?
Yeah.
So I don't know if I'm offended by the statue or if I love the statue or what. It's a cool statue.
You know what my counselor would tell me? He would be like, I see this face that has no image. He goes, okay, how does it make you feel? And I go, huh. And so I like, and he goes, lean into that. And his words are, he always goes, lean into that. And every time he says lean into that, the way that I hear it is like, why are you feeling that? You know, and I call that the rabbit hole of why. And if we just keep asking ourselves why, we generally get to the root of the issue if we're honest with ourselves.
Yeah, that's the hard thing. We have to be honest with ourselves, and it's hard to.
Well, we've been... I mean, we've basically been told not to our whole life.
You know, well, you're right.
Look at the examples we have in our world. I mean, we'll always be a product of our environment. We're not told to look inwards. In fact, we're shamed for it.
Yes, you hit the nail on the head.
Right? No, I would often question, why are we being shamed for going inwards? Well, I'll tell you, I've gone inwards, and there's a lot of power within yourself.
Yeah. You got to be yourself. You have to.
Yeah.
There's only one you.
Yep. There's only one you. Go on. Say what you're going to say.
There's only one you in this world, and there's never going to be nothing like you.
I always tell people that you're the only person living your life. Isn't it important you have a good relationship with that person?
Wow. That's deep.
Like, isn't it important that you have a good relationship? Other people are going to come and go.
So, why are we so fixated on making everyone else around us happy, but not ourselves?
Because society tells us to.
Yeah.
Because it's not it's called a toxic empath when we are giving of ourselves at our own expense, right? When we know better. And, you know, one of the things that I like to share with people a lot too is that, you know, we all have that voice inside of our head. Mm-hmm. We all do, right? And there is this voice telling us, do this, do that. And what that is something that's so beautiful and for your soul. And you're like, oh, if I could only do that, that would be the most beautiful thing for me. But that is the one thing that scares us the most. That's what we need. That's like, right. Like, why are we fighting with ourselves?
Right. Think of all the opportunities that we've missed in our lives because we've talked ourselves down from being our own selves.
Yeah. That's so in this IFS, it's called a critic and a self-saboteur, and they go in a category called firefighter. Yep. So we recognize when those ones show up and we reparent them and we say, hey, I appreciate you protecting me. And we all, I'll tell you, every single one of those has a trauma associated with it. It's man, it's deep work.
I have a cat that's trying to take over the show.
This is a cat. Oh, no. Well, I just lost an AirPod, too. I don't know how long this one's going to hold on. So. I think that's our sign. We've reached our limit on this episode.
That's right. Thank you guys so much for joining us. I'll let you do our closing thoughts. If there's anything else that you want to add, now go for it.
You know, I just want to add one little tidbit, and that is I encourage you to find time to try to play. Mm-hmm. And what I mean, and do something that's enjoyable for you, because what I have learned through this journey is I've been in survival for 6 years, and I've been so serious about healing and so serious about recovery. And yes, that was relevant and needed, but life is about balance. And I needed more balance. I needed the ability or the effort, whether or not I had the ability to connect with positive emotions or not, to continue to try to connect to play. Because the more we do things that we don't and haven't done, we're rewiring our neural pathways. And you will eventually and hopefully reconnect that. And as I'm coming out of my survival era, right, and I'm shedding the snake skin, I'm finding how hard that is to play, to let go, to have fun, to enjoy a joke. And so I'm trying to be more present in those moments. And I refuse to allow my brain injury to rob me of that peace anymore.
That's very well said. Very well said. Thank you guys for joining us. And thank you, Jason, for doing this.
It's my pleasure, man. I look forward to doing more with you. We obviously have a great little synergy. And it's my pleasure. Let's keep talking. Let's keep speaking. Let's keep being light for others. It's important. Yes. And I'm just grateful you have the ability to and for asking me to be a part of it. So thank you, my friend.
Yeah, anytime. Take care, guys.